here with Luis Scott-Vargas. Yep. Today we've got a question from Juan in
Bucaramanga, from Colombia.
There we go. Juan wants to know, what are the what are the most skill-intensive cards in Magic to play with or against?
Yeah, that's a great question, and we had certainly a good time thinking about it. I think that the first on our list has got to be Blood Braid Elf.
We're going...
Oh no, we said skill-intensive, not the opposite. Okay.
We did have a good time like quickly being like, okay, well, these cards are hard. Well, no, we're not. These cards are
Blood
easy
Blood
to play with. Yeah, like, we'll make a list of the easiest five cards. You could just sit down and win a game without
play trying. Blood Braid Elf attack, yes.
So yeah, we came up with a list of five we're going to go over, starting with number five.
Factor Fiction, which is not a skill in technical cards to play with as much as it is to play against.
Yeah. Because step one, wait to the end of
the reason
your
it was so good is that you just cast it, and no matter what, your opponent was screwed. But when you're sitting across from someone casting Factor Fiction, you have to divide the piles, and you have to do it. And it's really important. Like, the good rule of thumb is you want to put, like, the best cards in the smaller pile and the worst cards in the bigger pile, but you don't want to combine them. Like, if you had three good cards and two lands, assuming lands are irrelevant, it's generally like the best card plus a land, and then like, or the best card plus two lands, and then the two other spells. And that's a good, but it's such a hard card.
Again, you can't really apply basic rules to it.
That's the thing, there's no general rules. All the games are different. So, Factor Fiction is really tough to play.
Yeah, I mean, the joke about, I remember when the card came out, it was like...
EOTFO if you lose.
Well, it was like, draw five. Because you're going to look at the top five cards, and you're always going to get whatever one you need.
Yeah.
And so the question of that is, like, where do people make bad decisions? I mean, I can remember so many matches...
It's tough, too, because you don't always know what they want.
Exactly.
You don't know if they need the land. So, like, you undervalue lands, then they're... Like, I've played Factor Fiction a lot. I'd rather be playing it than playing against it. And I know that I've had times where my opponents, like, not only put the best card... plus the two lands I want in the three pile, and then the two cards I just don't want in the two pile. But it's hard to know what someone wants, which is why it's one of the more skill-intensive cards.
I just remember so many times where it's like, I just need to get more damage to my Psychotog.
Honestly, it's probably a card that is too easy to play with. It doesn't really reward skill, which is part of the problem with it. Next up, we've got a card which I like quite a bit, Sensei's Divining Top.
It is the topic of many a discussion.
The topic.
Yeah.
Banned from extended mostly because of time constraints, I heard, and probably because it's too good with counterbalance. Top doesn't appear to be one of the more skill-intensive cards when you think about it a lot in some games, because in some games they have a ton of mana, they're just topping every turn, that's not that hard. The games where it's skill-intensive are the games where you're tight on mana, and you need to plan out turns multiple turns in advance, and there, if you top wrong, you're really screwing yourself. Like, when you're only going to have a chance to top for one turn, and you have to plan out your next three turns with your top, including when to tap it and draw a card, to like maybe hit a land drop, all these sorts of things. I can see it's boring you because stifle the yawn, but that's a lot of people feel about top. So I think it's a very skill-intensive card, and I think there's some games that really reward you for using it correctly.
I think you've pretty much covered it. I mean, I could think of many games where...
I mean, that's all I could think of off the top of my head. So.
Let's just move on.
All right. I'll let you introduce the next one.
Coming in at number three on our list, we've got Cabal Therapy.
It's a card I like. I've played a fair amount with that card, too. It's funny. I've actually played with a lot with all the cards on this list. Interesting.
Huh. I don't know if I can make a comparison right now. But I will say that Cabal Therapy, it seems pretty obvious it would be a hard card to play with, just because if you play with it online, like, you go to cast it, and all of a sudden you're given a list of so many options of what to do with it.
Every card in Magic.
Exactly.
Well, yeah, I mean... The second time you cast it, not as hard, because you should know what's in their hand. The first time you cast it, I mean, Cabal, the whole point of Cabal Therapy is getting value by hitting them the first time. And hitting the first time, you have to think about a lot of things. I mean, the most obvious, at some point in the game, what do I lose to? And you have to figure out what you would least like your opponent to have and name that. But early in the game, it's really tough. You have to think the way they've played, what could they have in their hand, like, based on the lands they've played, like, what spells could they or could they not have. I remember a classical one was against Psychotog. I'd always play Rock against Psychotog. When you therapy them and they let it resolve, sometimes you name Counterspell anyway, because even if they had Counterspell, they won't name it hoping you'll miss.
Right.
So it's tough, but sometimes they just, won't have it, etc. You have to figure out, it's really like a lot of mind games, so I think Cabal Therapy is really good.
Again, what makes Cabal Therapy so great is it's a great card, a skill-intensive card to play with and against.
Yeah.
And you're just saying, like, being on the opposite side, being the Tog player, or being like, how defensive do I want to be? How much do I want to waste against the Therapy? Like,
yeah.
Do I want to blow spells on it, or do your worst?
What if they cast Therapy on you on turn two and you have two Counterspells in your hand? Like, the thing is, if you think about it, they might name Counterspell. So you may just, like, snap yes, and, like, maybe they won't name it, assuming you don't have it. Or if you think they're smart, you think about it too long, and then they're like, okay, he doesn't have a counter. Like, It's, again, you can get pretty deep in the tank when you therapy people. My favorite, though, was I remember playing Tog with Circular Logic. I got therapied. They named Circular Logic. They hit. I discarded it, but Madness, at that time, it doesn't anymore, but at that time, Madness cards stayed removed and in the Madness zone until you had priority again. But since it was his turn, I didn't have priority. Then he immediately goes to cast a spell, so I Madness the Circular Logic on the spell.
Always with the Mize.
That was just awesome.
Pretty rare. All right, moving on. Getting to the top two here, Brainstorm.
The reason I think Brainstorm, well, there's a number of reasons I think it's so skill intensive. And one is that because you should be playing it with fetch lands or other shuffle effects, when you Brainstorm, you're not putting two back, you're discarding two, essentially. So you have to figure out what your two worst cards are, and that's not that hard. But sometimes you need to keep some of those, and you have to figure out, well, maybe I draw one of these next turn, maybe I don't shuffle this turn. And just there's a lot of things, and the timing of when to play it is, I think, one of the things that most people get wrong.
To me, it's like top, only you're adding another element on top of it, if you will.
And I will, obviously. Because most people go land Brainstorm immediately, but when I've got fetch lands, I'd rather wait till turn two, Brainstorm, and immediately crack a fetch. That way you don't have to redraw any of the cards. And just by doing that, you get a ton more value. You, like in Legacy, which is where I've been playing Brainstorm the most, because, you know, it's unrestricted, you have to figure out maybe how to play Brainstorm around days. You have to figure out if they're playing Thought Seizes, you want to Brainstorm and hide your best cards instead. You have to figure out which lands to play. Like, if you lead with Underground Sea and they Wasteland it, that sucks. But if you lead with Delta, you don't want to crack it to Brainstorm. So there's a lot of decisions that go into Brainstorm, and I think it's a much more complicated card than most people. Like, I see a lot of people wasting their Brainstorms, and I think they shouldn't be doing that.
I mean, so many people are, like, I remember way back in the day, it was like, oh, it's the new Ancestral Recall. Like, you're still drawing three at one mana.
Well, it's Ancestral if you play it right, but if you don't, it just doesn't do anything.
That's not true. It replaces itself. It's like, draw a card. All
right, but if you just, like, cast Brainstorm, put two back, then draw the two, yeah. Brainstorm didn't really do much for you. Right. So. All right. So, number one.
The penultimate of, like, skill-intensive cards, from my perspective, I think we both kind of came to the same conclusion here.
It combines the difficulty of Factor Fiction with the difficulty of Demonic Tutor and more. Of course, the card I'm talking about is Gifts Ungiven.
For those who hadn't guessed already.
That not only when you cast it, the things you have to think about, you have, like, what cards do I need? What cards am I going to get? What combination of cards will make them give me what I need? What combination of cards will let me win the game no matter what they choose? In Vintage, this is the most common, where you gift and you're going to win that turn no matter what two they give you, but it's very complicated to think of the two. I've played gifts a lot in Vintage, you know, with my favorite deck, and I've gifted for all sorts of stuff, like Mox Jet, you know, Mox Sapphire, you know, Fetch Land, in addition to all, like, the powerful cards, and you don't usually want to gift for, like, sometimes you gift for Yawgmoth's Will, sometimes you gift for tutors that can go get you Will. And the thing is, once you're done thinking all this through and getting your cards, now your opponent has to think all this through. And they have to think, what does he have in his hand? Like, honestly, the most fun gifts were the ones where some of the combinations wouldn't win you the game, but you had to hope that they got it wrong based on the information they had. Like, often it was your opponent giving you the mana sources and bidding your powerful cards, then you going land Yawgmoth's Will or whatever.
And it was always like, I can remember when that card came out, like, one of the first tricks was, like, well, against a bad opponent, the first two cards they pull out of their deck, you immediately put in their graveyard.
Yeah.
And it was always like, so the immediate second-level thinking was, you get the two you don't want, put them out the table real fast, and take a long time to go find the other two cards.
Yeah.
That's like, there's always that mind game.
There's so many mind games you can do, and Gifts is just awesome for that. I would talk more about it, but, I mean, there's really not much else to say. Gifts is just one of the hardest cards to play ever. So, great question, Juan, and enjoy your store credit, which Sean will no doubt be adding shortly.
Yeah, sounds good. And again, for everyone out there, submit your questions for us to talk about on Magic TV to
MagicTV@ChannelFireball.com.
All right, there you go. Thank you for watching.
Thanks for watching.
I got too many emails that were off subject this week, so I'm just kind of like running with what I got.
I don't think they're off subject. They're about you doing your duty.
I see.
We have
I don't want to do my duty into the plant box.
We have it on tape that you were supposed to water this thing. That's a legally binding contract.
Legally binding contract.
I don't know. Do you want to do...
Do we want to brainstorm this one?
Yeah. Last time we missed Noble Hierarchy, that was pretty bad.
Pretty rare. All right. Moving on. Getting to the top two here. Brainstorm.
Yeah. When we were sitting around trying to think of cards for the list, this is one of the cards we brainstormed up.
It's a good one.
The reason it's so skill intensive.
Really? Butler, you killed it.
Is there a ghost?
There's a spider right here.
Tristan, afraid of the spider.
I was just surprised.
A spider's in.
There we go.
No chance that's not going on, by the way.
He cares about spiders, but not Humphrey.
Exactly.
No comparison.
The spider's not our co-host. Have a little respect. Yeah, as he stomps it.